Hello everyone and welcome to evolvingbeings.com. My name is Avita Ushel and today we have a special guest. His name is Robert Schwartz. Robert, hello.
Hi Avita, how are you?
Very good, thank you. And with Robert, we will be discussing his book, which is entitled Your Soul's Plan, Discovering the Real Meaning of the Life You Planned Before You Were Born. And along that line, we will be discovering and discussing one of the most pertinent topics that we have in common pretty much all throughout the earth as human beings. And that is the aspect of challenges, pain, and suffering in our life. And so we're going to try to understand deeper as to the purpose of all the different events that take place in our lives. And Robert is going to help us understand how they're not as meaningless as we often think. So Robert, to begin with, I know that in 2003, this is pretty much where your journey into this whole topic and writing your book began, as you had yourself a very special encounter. Can you begin by sharing a little bit about that and what took place?
Sure, I'd be happy to. What happened to me in 2003, Avita, is that I had been working as a self-employed marketing and communications consultant. I have an MBA. I was in the corporate sector for a number of years. And I found this work to be very unfulfilling. You know, I used to say to people at the time that I had the feeling that if I were to fall off the face of the earth, my clients wouldn't even know that I were gone. They would just plug someone else into my role and carry right along. But at the same time, I also had the sense that there was a higher calling or a higher purpose to my life, but I didn't know what it was, and I didn't even know how to figure out what it was. So on May 7th of 2003, as part of this search for the deeper meaning of my life, I did something that I had never done before, although it's commonplace for me now, and that is I had a session with a psychic medium. And in this session with the medium, she introduced me to the concept of spirit guides. I didn't even know what a guide was at that time. And she explained a spirit guide is a highly evolved, non-physical being with whom we plan our lives before we're born and who then guides us through our lives after we get here. And through this particular medium, I was actually able to talk with my guides. In that conversation, they said to me, "You planned your life, including your biggest challenges, before you were born." I had never even heard of this concept before. And I will tell you, Avita, I just shook my head and I said, "Well, why in the world did I do that?" And they said, "You did this for purposes of spiritual growth." So we went on and we talked about what some of my challenges had been and why I had actually wanted prior to birth to have those difficult experiences. This was my introduction to the concept of pre-birth planning. And although it was a bit of a circuitous path from there, it was really that session with the medium that kicked everything off, led to a complete career change, and eventually the writing of the book, Your Soul's Plan, Discovering the Real Meaning of the Life You Planned Before You Were Born.
Fascinating. So Robert, with this experience in your life, I'm sure, of course, it brought about profound changes in how you viewed life, and not just a career change, but also the meaning of life, because a lot of us, normally when something difficult happens, we see ourselves as victims. And a lot of us in our society to this day still live with this idea that someone else is in charge of what happens to us. But what you discovered was that this wasn't quite so. Can you talk a little bit more about that and how this pre-birth planning works that you have learned to this point?
Sure, I'd be happy to. I think it may be the best way to answer your question is to share with people one of the stories from the book, Your Soul's Plan, and this way they can get a sense of pre-birth planning in action. And here's the book here, Your Soul's Plan, Discovering the Real Meaning of the Life You Planned Before You Were Born. Oh, and we do have a website, yoursoulsplan.com. The book is organized by type of life challenge, and I chose to write about very common challenges because I wanted this book to be as helpful to as many people as possible. So there are stories in Your Soul's Plan about the pre-birth planning of illness, two stories in that chapter, a man who, believe it or not, plans AIDS and a woman who plans breast cancer. There are stories on the pre-birth planning of having disabled children, a very touching story of a woman who has two autistic sons. Stories about planning deafness, blindness, drug addiction, alcoholism, the death of a loved one, and accidents. The accidents chapter contains one of the most inspiring examples I've ever seen of somebody who took an awareness of her pre-birth plan and used it to do what you just referred to, and that is pull herself out of victim consciousness This is somebody who really used an awareness of her plan to turn her life around. Her name is Christina. She's about 60 years old now. Many years ago, when Christina was in her early 20s, she was employed as an administrative assistant at Pomona College in Southern California. One of her daily duties in that job was to retrieve her boss's mail. The mailboxes were located in the basement of the building in which she worked. So on one particular day, Christina descended those stairs to the basement mailboxes, just as she had done many times before. But on this day, unbeknownst to her, someone had planted a pipe bomb in the mailbox. So when she inserted her hand to retrieve the employer's mail, this bomb detonated. And the force of the explosion was so great, Evita, that it actually picked Christina up off the ground, hurled her 10 feet backwards against a concrete wall. There were 6-foot splinters of wood that were shot like arrows out of a bow into the wall around her. Two fingers were severed, both eardrums were ruptured, and flames from the explosion scorched Christina's body from head to toe. When she got to the hospital, doctors actually had to hold magnets over her eyeballs to extract the shrapnel from the pipe. So I see you wincing a little bit, and understandably, we're talking about a level of suffering here that's almost unimaginable to the average person. Now, Christina's recovery took 2 years and 10 reconstructive surgeries. At one point during the 2-year period, she was lying in her hospital bed in a tremendous amount of pain when suddenly she heard a voice inside her head, a voice that was not her own. It turns out that the force from the explosion, in addition to doing a lot of damage to her body, had also opened up her psychic gifts. Christina had become clairaudient. So the voice she heard inside her head that day was actually one of her spirit guides. And the guide said to her, "You planned this." And of course, she said, "Why?" Not an unreasonable question. And the guide told her, and here's what he said. He said, "You wanted, before you were born, to have an incarnation as a gifted healer. And you knew pre-birth that if you could heal yourself from the devastating effects of this bomb explosion, you could then take all of that wisdom and knowledge about healing and turn it outward in service to humanity." And this is, in fact, exactly what Christina did. She went on, after the 10 surgeries, to get a PhD in speech-language pathology. She set up a private clinical practice. And at this point in her life, she has healed literally thousands of people. She actually has the ability to go into someone's brain energetically, non-invasively, and restore language processing capability in people who have lost that due to stroke or accident. So she's a gifted healer, and the only reason she can do any of this is because she healed herself from the effects of that bomb explosion. Now, when I talked to her for the book, she said two things to me that I thought were remarkable. The first was, she said, "Rob, I have completely forgiven the person who planted that bomb." That alone, given her level of suffering, I think is extraordinary. But then she said something to me that was even more amazing. She said, "Rob, I am deeply grateful to the person who planted the bomb." Now think about that. This is someone who had magnets held above her eyes in the hospital, and here she is saying in complete sincerity that she's grateful to the person who inflicted that kind of suffering on her. This, to me, is the most inspiring story I've seen of somebody who used an awareness of her pre-birth plan to let go of anger, forgive, and then get to a place of complete gratitude. You know, you can well imagine she could have chosen to be angry for the rest of her life. She could have chosen to be bitter and resentful for the rest of her life. She might even have chosen to devote her life to tracking down the bomber and taking revenge. But because she came into an awareness of her pre-birth plan and really worked with it for a period of years, didn't happen overnight, she was able to get to a place of total forgiveness and then to a place of total gratitude. And I would suggest to your viewers that she's not unusual. Her story is, because it's a bomb explosion, but she herself is not. If she can do it, any one of us can do it in regard to our challenges.
Wow, that is incredible. Incredible. And, you know, I do hope and I think that anybody who is watching, for some people who, again, are still very much living from a space where life happens to us rather than we create, they might see this as, you know, out of the ordinary and miraculous and extreme. But for many more people, I think, who are waking up today to an expanded state of consciousness, this starts to resonate somewhere within that, yes, there is a reason for everything. No matter how horrible something may seem, how tragic, there is a reason. And the fact, that's why I always say, you know, the fact that we don't know some of these reasons I don't think we should be labeling things in that duality sense of the world that we most of us live in, bad, good, right? Happy, sad, etc. I mean, obviously some things are as they are and evoke certain emotions, but the gift is within every situation, as you showed through Christina's story. So in writing this book, you featured 10 stories all on different subjects.
That's right, yes. And let me say a word about the methodology. Each person that I interviewed, we focused on a particular life challenge. I mentioned those a moment ago. And then each of the interviewees had one, two, or sometimes three sessions with one of four mediums and channels who are my collaborators in Your Soul's Plan. And these particular mediums and channels, in one way or another, have the ability to find out what someone planned before they were born. For example, one of my colleagues is a medium in Arizona. Her name is Stacy Wells. Stacy has the ability to both see and hear the conversations we have with each other before we're born. So in working with Stacy, I could actually go into someone's pre-birth planning session and listen to them talking to their future parents, their future children, friends, lovers, employers, teachers, peers at school, enemies if they were planning to have enemies. And I put these conversations verbatim into the book. Another one of my colleagues, a medium in New York State, Corby Mitlide, has the ability to channel someone's soul, someone's higher self. So I could interview the higher self directly and say, what did you plan for this lifetime and why did you make those plans? So we come at it from these different angles. And then in the book, I present all of the information that came forward from spirit. It's a way, as you say, to give deeper meaning to the challenges we face. I think we live at a time in human evolution in which many people, when something seemingly bad happens to them, they feel that they're being punished by God or the universe, or maybe at minimum, they think that the event is random or arbitrary and has no deeper meaning. But what I'm saying in Your Soul's Plan is that, as you said a moment ago, Evita, there is always a deeper meaning, and you yourself planned the challenge, whatever it might be, in order to learn certain lessons. And the lessons we see souls wanting to learn are things like compassion, unconditional love, self-love, empathy, patience, and so on. I refer to these as divine virtues, and in my work, I see 30 or 35 of them that seem to come up more frequently than others. But basically, the soul is trying to further cultivate these divine virtues. And one way to do that in a very profound way is through the experience of a life challenge.
So, Robert, your intent in writing this book was to help people see, then, as you mentioned, also the deep meaning in suffering that may appear purposeless. Aside from writing this book, is this also something that you are working now one-on-one with people and helping them cope with, maybe through consulting, counseling, maybe connecting them through some of the mediums and channels?
I do. I offer what I refer to as spiritual counseling sessions. People can order these in the online store at yoursoulsplan.com. What happens frequently, not always, but frequently in a spiritual counseling session is that we will work with the divine virtues, and I will ask the client to talk in detail about the major challenges they faced in life. And when we go through the list of these divine virtues, what we generally find is that there's usually two or three or four, maybe five, that come out more through the person's experiences than the others. And so we start to see a very clear theme or themes in the person's life whereby the planned challenges are tending to elicit more of this handful of virtues. It becomes a very clear and also a very visual way when we lay it out on paper for the person to see what they planned before they were born. Also, as part of the counseling, I'm in the process, and I'm very excited about this, of learning hypnotherapy to regress people to their pre-birth planning sessions. I'll start offering those regressions in May of 2012, and that's something that I'm very much looking forward to providing to people.
Oh, I'm sure that will be a big help to so many. Now, when you look at some of the patterns, or some people who are resistant to learning, perhaps for the first challenge, do you see that the challenges continue to come up in different, maybe louder, more extreme ways?
That is, in fact, exactly what happens. And what's interesting, Evita, is that when I interviewed people for Your Soul's Plan, even though the interviewees didn't know each other or have contact with each other, I noticed that many of them used the same expression to refer to the phenomenon you just described. They would say the universe hit me over the head with a cosmic 2x4. And that was always in reference to a particular kind of challenge coming back around again and again in increasingly intense form. Well, I'll share with you a story that came up in the research. This person's story is not in the book, but it illustrates the phenomenon that you just described. I spoke with a woman who, many years ago, when she was a young mother, she had a daughter who was 7 at the time. And they were at a swimming pool one summer. The mother was lying in a lounge chair next to the pool. The little girl was playing in the water. All of a sudden, the daughter jumped up out of the water, ran over to her mother and said, and mind you, this is a girl who previously had never said anything unusual, and said to her mother, "You're not waking up the way you and I planned together before we were born, so you're going to have a really bad accident." Well, as you can imagine, the mother was horrified, both to hear her daughter say such a strange thing, but also at the content of what was being said. In any case, about a year after the daughter said that, this woman had a car accident which did not trigger a spiritual awakening. A year later, she had a worse car accident, which did not trigger a spiritual awakening. And a year later, she had a still worse car accident, which finally triggered a spiritual awakening. And the spiritual awakening was what she had intended to come out of these accidents, which she herself planned before she was born. This is the pattern that I see again and again, whereby if the intended lesson isn't learned by the personality, it cycles back, becomes more intense, and keeps doing that until the intended lesson is learned. Now, I don't say that to trigger feelings of fear in any of your viewers. That's exactly the opposite of what I want. I would like my work to reduce the amount of fear in the world. But I think it is important to share what I saw in my research, and this is something that I did notice as a pattern that came up again and again.
Incredible. Wow. And so when you work with people, and of course through the work in this book and such, you've obviously heard from so many people worldwide, the different examples of their suffering, of their challenges, etc. One of the questions that I know is very common on many people's minds, especially today, especially as people are, you know, I think facing two extremes. One extreme is, of course, more poverty, more pain, more extreme hardships. We see what's happening economically. We see what's happening with, you know, earth changes and you know, shifts and such. And then there's the other side of people where they're awakening and they really want to help people. They want to make sure that nobody's suffering. While I find that is extremely noble, I find that so often people don't appreciate or understand why somebody else might need to go through something. And I'm not saying we need to, you know, we should step back and not try to help people. But do you know what I'm trying to say? How can, you know, maybe how do you explain to people why some of the things are happening and that they're not necessarily the way we would call, you know, bad?
I think part of the answer to your question is that there is a very big difference in the human perspective and the soul perspective. And there are several things that distinguish those two perspectives. One is that, you know, when we're here in body and we have just the human perspective, if we're suffering, the suffering feels as though it's going on for a very, very long time in some cases. But from the soul perspective, an entire lifetime is really as brief as a clap of thunder. It's here and then it's gone. Also, the soul is acutely aware, much more than the personality, that whatever we learn here becomes part of the soul for all eternity. Also, the soul is very much aware, more so than we are, that no one is permanently harmed by anything that happens here. So when you consider those three differences, that a lifetime is actually very brief, no one is permanently harmed by anything that happens here, and yet the wisdom that comes from the lifetime becomes part of the soul for all eternity. From that perspective, it actually does make sense that a soul would plan before birth to go through a big challenge. But we lose sight of that perspective when we come into body.
Yeah, very much. I think we get stuck in so many of the illusions that we think this physical self is so real and everything we do, everybody we interact with is so real. So that, I mean, those three points, they're so valuable, and I hope, you know, everyone really just even takes a moment to reflect on what you just said, because they could be so life-changing and powerful. So Robert, I find your work so incredible, because again, part of my work is empowering people and helping them understand that, you know, there are no victims and there are no villains. We really are co-creating together for the best of each of our personal and collective spiritual evolutions. And so to start wrapping up, what are maybe some of your closing words of wisdom in how you try to help people, and just expand in a few words?
Well, one of the thoughts I would like to leave your viewers with is something you alluded to a few seconds ago, and that is, we're not who we think we are. When we come into body, we become identified with the body, the personality, our thoughts, our feelings, and many people become very identified with what they perceive as their faults and limitations. All of these things are things that you have, things that you carry, but they're not who you really are. The central idea here is that just because you have a thing, that doesn't mean you are the thing you have. For example, if you have a horse, obviously that doesn't mean that you are a horse. And by the same token, just because you have a body, you have a personality, you have thoughts, you have feelings, that doesn't mean that you are any of those things. Those are things you have, things you carry. Who you really are is a holy, eternal, courageous soul. And this is why the original title of my book was Courageous Souls, because it takes a tremendous amount of courage to plan a life, to plan life challenges, to incarnate on earth. This is who each and every one of us really is, a holy, eternal, courageous being.
Beautiful, beautiful. And I do have one last question. With all this work now going almost on a decade, have you found that your personal suffering, or were you able to transcend basically the personal physical suffering here?
I would not say that I've transcended it completely. I'm certainly a soul having a very human experience. But I think there's a big difference in my perspective, which now both diminishes the suffering and makes it more brief. Mm-hmm. So in other words, if something quote-unquote bad happens in my life, I'll ask myself the question, if I planned this before I was born, why might I have done that? It doesn't even matter really whether or not I did plan it before birth, or if I know whether or not I planned it before birth. It's just asking the question, if I planned it, why did I do that? And when I ask that question, then I can get at the deeper meaning in a much more conscious way, be less reactive and more responsive, learn the intended lesson, whatever it might be, in a much more conscious manner. And by doing that, it reduces the suffering and makes the suffering of much less duration.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful words of wisdom, Robert. Thank you so much. So, Robert, to finish off, can you share where your book is available and also your website again for all of our viewers?
I'd be glad to. Your Soul's Plan is available on all of the Amazon sites, through my website at yoursoulsplan.com, through all the major bookstores. And I particularly want to encourage people, ask your local library to order it. That way, there's no charge to you. But more importantly, it becomes a resource that's available to many other people. Because I hear from a lot of people, Evita, who say, I'd like to read your book, but I can't afford to buy a book. There are more people in that circumstance than you might imagine. So if people ask their local library to carry Your Soul's Plan, then it becomes available as a healing resource to all of those people.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you so much. And thank you for the work that you are doing, because again, I know how meaningful it is, how empowering it is, and how life transformational this can be when people tap into the meaning and purpose behind every event in their life or in that of their loved ones. And so, Robert, thank you for taking the time also to speak with us today.
Thank you. I appreciate it, Amina.
You're very welcome. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. Until next time.